therefore material circumstances are going to be so encroached and damaged by homophobia, we need to get involved with our trade union movement and work in solidarity with them to have our dignity, respect, our material psychological well-being protected by that great body.
I think trade unions have such a huge history in Ireland, particularly, of influencing change. And I think it's really important that SIPTU now has the LGBTQ network.
And I think the more visibility, the better. The more resources that LGBTQ people have to reach out to if they feel the need, the better. The more organisational and organised voices that there are and groups like SIPTU LGBTQ, the better.
Yes, homophobia, the hate that dare not speak its name, is still a reality and is a reality in the workplace which we as trade union officials experience on a regular basis. Homophobia is institutionalised through Section 37 of the Employment Equality Act, a piece of legislation that is a shameful reflection on the official attitude towards LGBT teachers.
In 2009, the National Lesbian Gay Federation, which is now the NLGTF, in conjunction with this trade union here, SIPTU, conducted a burning issues survey, they called it. And it was a large sample, 1,100 people participated. What were the burning issues, according to the lesbian, gay, bisexual and trans people interviewed or sampled? You might expect it to be marriage. No, the top concern was to be able to work without fear of discrimination. So it was workplace issues were the top pressing concern.
Well, my problem really, though, is that, yes, they may have increased visibility of LGBT people, but it's always in the same ways. I mean, the kind of stuff that I always get asked to do is always this silly stuff. They want you to be sitting at a bar as a punchline in some sketch. Last night I was at this event with Dara O'Brien, the panel in Vicar Street, and every time the word ass got mentioned, and it got mentioned a few times by accident, the audience would all titter and giggle when I was on the stage.
And I don't understand why presenters and broadcasters and journalists, when they're given a definition of marriage from somebody who opposes marriage equality, why that definition cannot be separated as a religious definition and not a civil definition. Because we're talking about a referendum on civil marriage, and the debate is being framed as a referendum about religious marriage. Or, if you listen to all of these debates, it often feels as though the referendum is about banning straight people from getting married, such as the kind of veracity of that side.
Well, we've got a really handy campaign to get behind, which is that the discrimination faced by people under, paradoxically, our equality legislation, 37.1, which enshrines the right to discriminate against lesbian and gay teachers and medical workers in most schools and hospitals in this country, which are under a religious, that is, Catholic ethos. Why is that not the issue?
You asked earlier about getting the parents involved. I would actually say that it's more important to get children who've been raised by gay couples to be involved, because the anti-same-sex marriage side has no facts to win on. I mean, we all know that. So what they constantly bang on about is the emotional buttons that they try to push, and of course children is their big one. Won't you please think of the children? And one of the most effective ways to combat that is to actually allow those children or young adults, whoever, to actually tell their own stories. And I think it's one of the most incredible sort of gaps in the whole thing is how rarely we ever hear from those people. And yeah, I know it's unfortunate and not fair that we would all, you know, that they would have to sort of carry the can in that way. But there are some really fabulous young people who have been raised by gay and lesbian couples, and some of them are fabulous speakers and can really tell their stories really effectively. And so I think it's unfair to expect that much from them. But I think in this case, you know, we should expect that. I asked them of it. So that's, I think that's one of the most important prongs.
And I think we, on a grassroots level, not just always looking to the lobby groups, or to figures like Panti who are doing great work. But I think at a grassroots level, we need to make people take notice of us. And I think, like, let's say in the next year to come, I think we need to be coming out to our communities. We need to be banging on doors. We need to be making ourselves available and making ourselves known to local media.
The next year is going to be one of the most exciting years of our lives. We're going to get to fight for something which is really deep and meaningful and profound for us. I think Olivia Leary had a brilliant article talking about it. Tough slavery just didn't disappear. It had to be fought for. We'll be fighting for our rights again.
Having those voices, rather than, you know, people like myself out there doing that, having children, having mothers, having grannies, as somebody who's just recently become a grandmother, I think we need the grannies. We need the grannies saying, I want my grandchildren to be able to do this. So, you know, it's one of the reasons why this network is going to be so important, because as a minority group, we need the majority out there saying this is an issue for all of us in Ireland.
So what is the media at? The media is in a really weird position at the moment. People don't really know how to talk about these kind of things. You know, some people are overcompensating, some people are pulling back. And I think that that point on journalists being educated and producers being educated is paramount. The amount of ignorance that is out there on, like, you know, it's, you can't really blame journalists, you know, because you can't know everything about every single issue. But if you're going to put people on a platform, give them a platform in the studio where they are consistently cite discredited research as fact and not pull people up on that, you know, that's reprehensible.
Well, this is an auspicious occasion. It's actually about time that SIPTU came out of the closet. I've had my suspicions for a long time. And I've always thought that Liberty Hall would be a fabulous name for a drag queen.